of yourself. We're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show Network with Dr. Kathy Obear, author of Turn the Tide. And we thank you for comments and supporting the last few shows that we've done with Dr. Obear, keeping the dialogue going. Today, we're going to be talking about difficult situations whites want tools to engage effectively. And what will happen inevitably, particularly in the corporate sector and academic sector, is that there'll be meetings that you'll have to attend. And what's happening with, because the country is turning brown, if you will, white privilege is being challenged, or whiteness literally is being challenged. And there's a lot of whites that are just don't know what to say, what to do, and they're totally uncomfortable. We talked about this with Dr. Robin DiAngelo about white fragility. And one of the major issues that many whites have when it comes to race relations is just avoidance altogether. Let's talk about it, Dr. Obear. You have a list here that you sent me.
That is just partial.
Partial list. Yeah, well, I'm sure if you sent me all of it, it would be probably, I wouldn't be in the room right now. But you know, this was fantastic. I enjoyed this. So do you want me to read some of these, or do you want to start with just kind of setting the tone of what we're going to be talking about from the perspective of a white person?
Well, I think, as I've mentioned, I'm in the middle of writing a book for whites about how to show up and be effective change agents, partner with folks of color, father leaderships of people of color. And so I sent out a survey and I asked, where do you feel stuck? What kinds of issues do you deal with that you don't know what to say? And I asked a couple more questions. What keeps you going? So I have a lot of stuff for future conversations. But as I was reading these, I was really struck with the pattern and theme, which I so related to, of well-intentioned whites that know enough to engage, but then something happens, we're caught off guard and we get triggered and we go into fight, flight, or freeze, either over-aggressive, most of the time frozen like a deer in headlights, what do I do? Or I came up with another F, floundering, which I'm going to be writing about.
Oh, I like that one too, yes.
You know, okay. I'm kind of like trying this, trying that. I call it throwing spaghetti against a wall. So I thought it might be fun to have a few of these conversations where, you know, we share what are these common situations that some whites are saying, I don't know what to say. I share what I'd say, you'd share what you say. We just see if it's useful for folks. Because here's what I realized. There's no checklist. There's no recipe. Mm-hmm. And yet the more I practice, the more I do my self-work, the more I have confidence. In those moments, there are good tools that I can use that then I can reflect, get centered, and find a way to engage. So I think there are better ways, but that's just my opinion, and we'll throw some of those out today.
Well, so one of the scenarios is and I can relate to this because we can reverse this and we do it. We're in the same situation. We do the same thing when whites are not around. But one thing that we're noticing here is that when whites are getting together and they're having a conversation and their biases come out, you have in quotes here, you know, hey, we're on the same page and it's safe for me to talk about brown people or melanated people, people of color. So talk to us about that consciousness and that faux pas, because we talked about that in our last show about some whites that when they are with a group of their peers, you don't want to be the one. You don't want to be the one white person to call out another white person on their biases, and that creates so much angst and anxiety. Speak to us about this quote.
Well, I think most whites would admit when they're honest, you got friendships, you have hierarchical supervisory relationships, whether it's an organization. And to put our white privilege and access on the line and all the advantages we've gotten, because when whites speak up and speak out and hold other whites accountable, they could lose access. They could lose their access to privilege in that situation. Now they can go somewhere else and still get white privilege, but in that moment, they might lose a relationship to the leader or friendship. If you do it within relationships, I remember a time my white partner, early in our relationship, I was just writing about this today, came home and she'd been going to all these racism workshops that her organization put on, and she was talking about white privilege and whiteness, and I looked at her like, what in the world are you talking about? I don't get it. And I actually was irritated. What was really going on is she was moving ahead faster than I was. Mm. And she's over 6 years younger, so I was not happy. I was the one doing this consulting for pay, and she was working in an organization. And seeing her, if I accepted what she was saying, I had to then look at myself and realize what I still didn't know and where I was incompetent, which I slowly did. But in that moment, it was jarring. So I've been on all sides of this, where I've been the one confronted by whites, as well as the one trying to have whites take a look at their behavior. So this one is tough, because when there's a racist comment or some racial tone to it, how do you engage in a way that you don't lose the whites? Here's what I used to do. I used to throw a bomb. I used to say, that was racist, and then feel all good. But the end point was nobody learned, nobody changed. They just didn't have me in the room anymore. And so I wasn't being a white ally change agent. I just got to feed my ego. And so instead, someone makes a racist comment to say, well, can you say more about that? I'm not sure I understand. By the way, most every incident we come up with, I'll probably start with a question. I do that so that I can get centered. I get a little more information, because the chance is 1 in 1,000 times I might have misunderstood. I might have heard what I thought myself, because I still have racist thoughts. So I think it's always a good strategy, most likely, to always ask a question to get more information. So whether it's, can you tell me what you meant? Or I was thinking about in the U.S., Thanksgiving is coming up. And for some folks, that's a time of gathering with other people. And for many whites, that'll probably mean dealing with whites who you don't see that often. Mm-hmm. And so especially in this post-election season, because that'll be in about 3 or 4 weeks, what do you say? And so I like to ask, well, what was your intention? What were you? What was behind your statement? So that's a little different. The first one was tell me more. The second one is, it's a little more confrontive, like, what were you trying to communicate with that comment? Because I'm not sure it came across the way you meant. Mm-hmm. And you might even notice my tone changed in the role play. Mm-hmm. I like to engage people in the least confrontive way possible at first to see if that will turn it around. Mm-hmm. And then there's a whole continuum.
Well, otherwise, you're going to trigger them.
And then they get triggered and you're triggered. You know, you're going to be fighting as opposed to. So I like to enter, if possible, in a way. And you can see my body movement kind of sideways. Many whites, I don't know if it's most, will hear what they said, and, oh, I didn't mean it. And then you have another, well, tell me what you did mean. Or, well, then you know the impact of that. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what do you think the impact was if the kids were in here listening to this, or if new employees heard that? I really want you to come across as an effective leader. And when you say those things, people will not necessarily see you in the best light. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So there are many angles to get whites to care. Go ahead.
I got to throw this in here. I said, now, you know, so these conversations you wouldn't attribute to just locker room talk. I had to. I'm sorry. Had to do it.
How do I want to approach this? Whites, when we're together, will have these conversations and not hold each other accountable, whether it happens in the business locker room, the home locker room, or an athletic locker room. I do believe these comments happen. What you're referring to of what was said by a presidential candidate was way beyond what I think happens in locker rooms. And I mean, I know that's in your humor, you're saying this was about sexual assault and sexual predator and sexual violence. Yeah,
it's a serious topic, but I mean, I'm not taking that.
I liked how you got that in there.
Yeah, but I had to put that in there, and so when we're talking about these, if you will, awkward situations, right? Another one that you have, that I've heard this, you know, how can I say anything when I haven't had that experience? So in that, you know, there are obviously white people who have not had a black experience, or have, at a surface level, they haven't really been around black people, particularly those in urban areas, harsher areas, where the economics and academics are lower than some of the blacks that they, or African Americans or melanated, whatever the terms we want to, that they know and they might call associates or peers that they're more comfortable with. you know, that's kind of a legitimate question. You know, how can I say anything when I haven't had that experience? Speak to that.
Well, I join you that because of housing segregation, the school system segregation, most whites have not had easy access to build relationships across race, and we also don't do much effort or work to do that because we're scared of being called racist, all those other things we talked about. And so the other dynamic is in these moments, most whites that I work with think the only way to engage in the conversation is to talk about people of color's experience. Another trap they fall into is if they've read a book or they watched a documentary, they might come in at the intellectual level and say, oh yeah, so-and-so said this. But what we're trying to do is show like we're cool, we're down. Here's my best advice to whites, and this is what I try to do, is come in and talk about your experience as a white person, what you know whites do, and join from that. So folks of color, melanated folks, are talking about experience of racism. The other day on the phone, African-American woman was talking about beyond cumulative impact at one more killing of an unarmed black man by police. And she said, I'm at racial trauma. I have no more words. I don't want to put another email. I can't have another open forum. I've got no more words. I don't have anything to tell my son. And I actually felt overwhelmed at that moment because her depth of triggered emotion was more than I've sat with in a while. Mm-hmm. And I just said, I can't imagine what that's like. As a white person, I can't even get close to knowing what that's like, but my heart is heavy and full, and I just want to be able to support you in any way I can. I don't know if that was useful, but she kept talking. She didn't hang up.
Well, sometimes you need that cathart, you know? Because it's just dissipating that energy. Otherwise, you keep it in, even though it's going to be in, because it's a... Now we're talking about Dr. Joy DeGruy's work, Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. We're talking about the re-injury of the intergenerational trauma of slavery, white privilege, white supremacy. And you use the term accumulative impact or accumulated impact. And when you have, when we wake up and we see, we turn on either television or our computers, we go to a social, what our preferred social network is, and there it is, it's inescapable. And so there's another, so it's not an isolated event, it's an added event, an augment to the insult. So sometimes we do need that cathart. We just need to get it out. But it doesn't mean that we're healed from it, because there's a difference between a disorder and a syndrome. We're dealing with a syndrome, which is systemic and ongoing. A disorder is something that we can probably go and get, you know, to the doctor, or take some psychiatric help or counseling and move past the disorder. Well, racism is not a disorder. Systemic racism and scientific racism is not a disorder. So go ahead. I just want to throw that in there.
Well, I love that. And the other thing is what I have done and what I've seen whites do that I think has been useful is to say things like, I've actually done that, or I see whites doing this. So say something that confirms that what the person of color is saying is not way out there, or you're going to fight them. So if they're talking about a workplace dynamic and say, yeah, this just happened to me. I was in meetings. I was cut off. My ideas were discounted. And the white person said it. Then they got listened to. Then for the white person, not just to sit there and learn and on the backs of folks of color, but to say, I actually just saw that last week. Or I remember when I did that. I can't imagine the impact of what my behavior had. But today, I still see that happening.
You haven't
stopped there. Don't try to fix it. Don't try to, please tell me I'm okay. Just acknowledge, affirm, confirm, and stop.
I think that's powerful. I really do. I mean, and you know, I know some people always have pushback on all of this, because some people, some of us, we're just so sick and tired of being sick and tired that there's just an anger that you know, there's a fire that can't be put out. And I get it. And I get to accumulative impact as well sometimes. And as I joke often, that's why you will always see me with a scotch and a cigar after a show. So because I have to figure out a way to handle it.
I talk about club soda and pet my cat.
Everybody has their thing. That's it. Complaint that Denise has an attitude about being on the search committee. Committee. She might say something like, you know, well, we are post-racial. I don't like the terms you use, you know, black, Latino, white. Can't you just call us people instead of referring to specific races? Yep, that'll get the eyebrow raised right over here. Talk to us about that and how should we deal with that? And I know you have dealt with it. You have done it. So let's go.
You know, it depends where the setting is, but say if that's in a workplace, I might ask a question. Well, tell me more about why it's important to you that I just call everyone people here. And I'd hear a little bit more. And my intent would be to join them on, yes, we're all human. This is kind of related to All Lives Matter.
I was just getting ready to put that in. Yeah, because now we've got T-shirts and all of this, All Lives Matter. Are you serious? This is just another insult of white privilege and white, not even white privilege, because we know that white privilege and supremacy is there. But this is white fragility at its best, right? This is, if you need to open up or do a search criteria for white fragility, All Lives Matter. That would be the headline. It's fantastic. Great.
So let's kind of do both here. One is, if someone says, yeah, I'm a race, I'm the human race, we're all people. Again, I want to meet people where they are, because these are usually white folks, though sometimes folks of color will say the same thing to me, which is a different angle for me. As a white person working with someone who's in someone targeted by racism, there's different things to consider when I'm engaging. But if it's a white person, I might say, well, I agree with you, we're all human beings. And what do you believe all human beings deserve? I would say the same thing to somebody who says all lives matter. Tell me more why all lives matter. And when we matter, what do all human beings deserve? And so I'll have them tell me some. Then I'll say, I agree, everyone deserves respect, safety, to have a livelihood. And what if I were to tell you that data has showed that there's differential experiences based on group identity? Now, I wouldn't use that kind of jargon and language if folks hadn't had access to that. But I might say, if you knew that because of people having the same group identity, they were treated less than, and they weren't getting access to what you say all people deserve. And I just actually thought of this while I was preparing, taking a shower. I might use the angle of saying, you know, back in the 80s and 90s, early 90s, folks realized that people with disabilities were denied basic human rights. Access to so many things, learning, housing, work. And so it took a long time, but finally Congress passed the ADA. I should know what that means. I think it's a disabilities, American Disabilities Act. I think it's 1992, a year off. And I'd say, so my guess is you agree with that kind of legislation that opened the doors to fairness and equity. I see as a white person, the same thing is happening again, that folks are saying, people of color, cross race, but in this case, African Americans are particularly experiencing different experiences with police, and the data shows it. And Black Lives Matter in housing, in healthcare, in interacting with police, there's just a different life experience, a different lifespan. And I know this is a lot for you to hear right now, so let's keep talking. I agree with you, all lives matter, but in this context, in this time, I really put my stake in the ground that Black Lives Matter, people of color lives matter, because as a white person, I get so much more access and safety and treatment that's positive. And then I might throw in the story that literally happened last week. I have to make a note and pay this ticket because I forgot. I haven't been pulled over in years. It might help that we don't have cars. Driving down the road, 10 miles or 11 miles over the speed limit, police officer pulls me over, rolled down, treated me with such respect. Did not ask me to get out of the car, didn't apologize, but energetically said, you were over the speed limit, this is a crash zone, I have to give you a ticket, so almost apologized. And I'm thinking the whole time, I wish that hadn't happened, but what an experience that I know in 2016 as a white person, what white privilege looks like when an officer engages me. And so I share that story now to encourage whites who are listening to think of what stories can you tell, not out of this energy, but just like, here was my experience to show the difference. I could tell a realtor experience about getting a just a few experiences to show what white privilege looks like, to show whites who are saying all lives matter, why do we have to talk about race, that it does matter. Statistics help, but those personal stories can really maybe shift the energy.
No question about it. Thank you for sharing that too, because we all know, had that have been a melanated man or woman, particularly a man, that would have been a different story. Not to say that every single black man that gets pulled over is going to be executed, but the temperament and tone is radically different than that of non-melanated people. You talk about, and this gets in a little harsher language, excuse me, this language gets in a little harsher language when we're talking about white fragility. So some white folk, they either avoid, some get passive, and then some get very aggressive, and you know, the language of, well, I don't have any slaves. Can't they just let the civil rights movement die? We have a black president, for God's sake. What more do they want? You know, I threw that in there last week. You know, I never discriminated against anyone, and I never killed any of them, so let it go already. So these are literal things that white folks say. And this, I would assume, not being gender biased, but this would be more of a masculine or hyper-masculine tone. But I don't know if there are females that would say the same. So I'm treading on thin territory talking to you, Kathy, because I know your background and your history. But it just seems a little bit more masculine to me that, I could see a guy saying this, not necessarily a white woman saying this to that degree. But I'm sure it does happen. Correct me,
You got me thinking. I bet it happens across. I'm sorry.
That's it. Be more than happy to tear me up and rip into me if I was being gender biased or, you know, sexist.
Well, I'm just only talking about my experience. My guess is I've heard comments across all genders, but if I had been taken data, and I bet I've heard it more from people that present male and identify as male. And here's my wonder, is that the more privileges you have, the more room you have to think I can say whatever I want.
Mm-hmm.
Just be authentic and real is how it's being phrased in the current discourse in the presidential debates we're having in 2016. So the more, I think, privilege you have, so it could be that some white women, and I know, I thought these comments in my life.
Mm-hmm,
I remember resisting, thinking, I didn't own slaves. Why are you coming at me about this whiteness? I'm just an individual. I would never say anything bad or do anything bad. And so I wonder if people with some marginalized identities or don't have as much empowerment may not say it, or are smart enough not to say it publicly. But white women have these same attitudes in my experience. So again, I'd probably engage with, well, tell me more. and why does it matter that you didn't own slaves? Especially with the energy that you role played that's very common. And so when folks come at me with that kind of energy, they're triggered. Doesn't mean they're triggered by something we've said today. It could be what they brought in. They anticipate that they're going to be beat up in my workshops or that they'll be attacked. And so they come in on the offensive. So I'm just like, well, tell me more. And then I'll do what I just did, is like, you know, I used to think that. I remember being in a workshop that I said, I didn't own slaves, so why do I have to talk about racism? And then I might continue the story and say, and then the white facilitator I came to appreciate said, well, I didn't own slaves either, but actually in my family, they didn't, but they benefited from the slave trade three centuries ago. But even if we don't go that far back, my family was able to accumulate wealth, and this is a true story in my family I'm writing about. My father was in World War II, and just when he finished that, came back, went back to get a master's in engineering, and then he and my mom bought a house soon after that. The GI Bill, as you know, but I didn't know, I don't think it actually said no people of color who fought can have access, the way it was implemented was basically no people of color hardly got access, but all whites did. And so I could tell a story from my lifetime that our family was able to move solidly into professional class, middle class, professional class, because of the GI Bill, which was inherently implemented racist, which was based on racist attitudes going all the way back to the 1600s that just have kept going. And that the white privilege and access I got as a white person and then financially set me up to then go to college, get a master's, go to my doctorate, be in private college and high school. All of that got set up by the GI Bill in my mind and my experience. And so I didn't own slaves, but the whole system that started slavery and has perpetuated differential treatment and experiences and white supremacy, I wouldn't use that language in that moment. I said, so I don't know about you, but today I still see how, and I'll tell another story, and this is true. I'll be training with a woman of color, happens to be multiracial, biracial, presents Latina to many people. And I say, when I speak, everybody listens. I'm never questioned. I'm not challenged. Nobody asks me to repeat what I've said. 3 out of 4 times when she's introducing a task or directing, if we're working together, someone says, I didn't understand what you said. Could you repeat that? Or they just won't do what she asks and will just go do what they want. When I see it once, it's a problem, but the pattern over years, and it's not just work with her, and I've worked with other women of color, I see the same dynamic. And I know it because when I'm a white woman partnering with a white man, then I get that negative, like, or sometimes with an African-American man that I work with a lot, who also is highly respected, he'll get heard, and when I try to speak, the sexism really comes out. So that's why I know this is a dynamic that's not at the individual level. So I might tell that story to say, I noticed differential treatment. So I don't own slaves today, but I get treated differently as a white person. So you may not be able to relate to any of this, but have you ever been in a meeting where you've seen, and then I might give a few examples.
Well, you know, I like this because I remember having Debbie Irving on, white like me, and she was talking about the GI Bill and the inherent racism and that. And that is, when people say that institutionalized racism doesn't exist, didn't exist, well, that's institutionally, I mean, you know, again, that's, you know, if you want to just do, you know, put a photo up in Wikipedia, that would be a great example of racism at an institutional federal law level. We can always go back to, you know, the anti-miscegenation laws of 1681 and the beginning of white people being termed, deemed white, and the classification of white and black as legal under law. Well, you know, this is difficult for particularly white men. This is difficult because, you know, I was watching Jimmy Kimmel on a YouTube clip because I think yesterday was Columbus Day or something.
Indigenous Day, yeah.
And we all know what's happening is little Becky's going to school in her little white, you know, neighborhood and her little pigtails, and she's learning that America is not that great in terms of our history, and it is causing a major shift in white communities and white families. When we talk about Columbus, you know, because when I was coming up, I thought that it was a white dude that came from somewhere else, came to this country and said, hey, this is great. We're gonna call it America and all. And now we understand ancestrally there is Africans here. I think they found the oldest artifact is in San Diego, and I think it's 60,000 years old. The first African that came to the first African that was on this continent that morphed into the Indians. And when we look at this, the technology, the internet, the speed in which we're able to get information about America, white folk ain't looking too good. I mean, you know, it's like white history is not looking too good. And it's almost now becoming a constant reminder, a constant hum that's in the room. And we're dealing now with cognitive dissonance. After, you know, we understand the white fragility, but the cognitive dissonance is that as a white person, I don't want to feel bad all the damn time every time I see a black person. So consciously or unconsciously, I just don't want to be around them because it's a mirror that reflects, reminds me of my ancestral connection or possible contribution to this, and I don't know how to handle it.
So I love you bringing this up. A couple of things come up for me. One is, I relate that I was taught those same things. Columbus was a hero. Today, when I'm in workshops and we're around that, or we're talking about misinformation, I'll walk over to somebody and I'll just grab their briefcase, or their, I'll just pick up a book bag or a computer, and I'll walk away with it. And people are looking at me, and I'm like, look what I just discovered. I'm sure I saw that somewhere or got channeled, but just that moment. And then, I mean, I love this, you're at the cumulative impact of whites, of just learning that what we were taught was lies, or at least not the full truth. It, most of it that I got taught, and I taught, because I was a student teacher in history, was white propaganda, in my opinion, white supremacist propaganda. Mm-hmm. So I'd want to truly go right there and just ask the question, what are you feeling? What's the impact of realizing that some, if not a lot of what you were taught was not accurate, and that we were actually taught some lies? What is that like? And so instead of arguing about who did what, just go right to the conversation. And then again, that sets me or whomever the white person is to say, well, here's what I'm feeling. Can mm-hmm. you relate? Mm-hmm. The more we whites can go to feelings, our own stories, and then say, can you relate? Those are the strategies I think will invite whites to reflect. We're not pushing back, because you can't argue feelings and perspectives or life experiences as much. And the other thing is, I was mid-20s, probably 26, 7, before I really realized there were some whites that actively worked for civil rights in this country. Mm-hmm. I mean, I may have seen whites marching, but it was a white man that someone actually supervised, who was going to the Dr. King Center on Nonviolent Social Change. He was maybe early 20s, a graduate student. He's like, why don't you come along? So my partner, it's now my wife, we went along for a week-long training, and some of the leaders, I mean, there's Harry Belafonte and some other key folk, I forgot her name. But there were white folks who would tell stories about how they were a part of. So the problem with our education system is we don't have a balanced view. Now, I'm not saying 50% of the whites have been active change agents throughout history, but there have been many whites who have been working for social justice a long time, whether there were folks around abolition of slavery. Now, I'm not saying they were perfect people. People that were working for women's rights, and not just white women's rights, but suffrage for all. And so how do we elevate and amplify the voices of more whites so that there are more white role models of how we can be? And then the whites that are doing work today, how can we make sure their stories and images are out there so whites can see that's what it means to be white? KKK, racist comments, yes, that's what whites do, but what it could mean to be white today is a change agent for social justice, and that's where I want to be.
Mm. Speaking of those role models, we were talking in the green room, and I think it fits into this narrative. We were talking in the green room about the new movie that was written, produced, directed, fundraised by Nate Parker, who finally got the movie made. About Nate Turner, and the movie is called Birth of a Nation, and I just saw it, and so I'm going to say, for first of all melanated people, you got to go see this movie. It's absolutely empowering and historical. For this, if you're not ready, for the non-melanated people, if you're not ready for this level of truth, you might not want to go see it just yet, but you need to go see it, because it's if you're not ready for that knock on the head, then you might want to maybe not go by yourself, maybe go with a group and discuss it afterwards, because I have never seen ever a movie about slavery, and I'm 58, I'll be 51 in November. I have never in 51 years seen a movie that is more accurate than this movie, as it relates to the psychology, the consciousness, the psychosis, the barbarianism of both wealthy and poor whites as it relates to slavery and owning slaves and how they treated slaves and why the rebellion of Nate Turner was so poignant. Not that he was the only one, but one that was most kind of famous in history, and why it was so difficult for Nate Parker to make this movie, and why he's getting such backlash and they're demonizing him, is like we were talking about in the green room. The first thing that they do whenever they show a black man or woman being killed is they run their record. Well, they had a criminal record. Well, that to some whites automatically shuts them down and says, oh, it was a justified killing.
Yeah.
And they're doing the same thing to Nate Parker, the guy who created the film, because, and he tells the story, there were black folk he went to and white folk that said, hey man, don't make this movie. Do not make this movie. They're not ready for this level of truth. And particularly on both sides. So there's some melanated people that can't watch this movie because they're too integrated, if you will, into the white supremacy system and institutionalized racism. And then, of course, there are some whites that absolutely won't be able to handle this at all. That being said, Doc, how... So I know you haven't seen it yet, and I know you're going to go see it. Do you recommend to, in your training, in your work, do you recommend certain movies? Do you do group trips with whites and say, let's go and collectively watch this and learn something? What is that something? And is that something that you would recommend for families that are trying to collectively grow? Because I think children need to see this, even though it's brutal, but I think kids need to see it, especially if you're understanding this whole thing about Columbus and just really true American history.
Totally. The more whites, whether it's in white caucuses, white book clubs, white movie going, and then intentionally debrief and talk about it. I remember seeing the movie Rosewood, which I might, I love that one. And it, just brutal, a pattern that I think probably happened across the South in many ways, and the North that we don't know, African-American neighborhoods flourishing and whites coming in and just destroying. So whether it's in Oklahoma, so the T one, what's the T?
Tuskegee.
No, not that one. The city in Oklahoma in like 1912.
Tulsa.
And this particular movie, we were talking about this. Again, all I know is what I read on Facebook and the news. And so the intersection of race and gender, he, like many folks accused of rape, he was not held accountable, or he was not found guilty, I think was the language. But there are many folks in social justice arenas are saying, don't go see it. And then you said, which really got my attention, who else in the media who's made movies that I just don't know, because African-American man, it might come out sooner, or this could be some of the backlash because the movie is so truth-telling. So it really got my attention. And at the crossroads of holding multiple perspectives and complexity, that's where I'm sitting today.
Yeah.
And how many movies have I watched and I haven't done the research on either the director, the writer? You know, there's one movie maker, I will not see his work because he was in sexual relations, sexual abuse with young children in his family. So, but I haven't done the work as a white person to research other movies I go to. So I will go with an open mind and open heart because I'm reading Underground, which is such a difficult book for me to read. Like you, I've studied about racism and slavery particularly for a long time.
I've done more than study. I've lived it.
You for the catch. Right.
Just had to throw that in there.
You throw right in. And this book has me back on my heels. I mean, yeah. Rosewood is hard for me to watch. This book was even more graphic in my mind. And so I stopped reading about 3 weeks ago, and I was on a call with some other whites today doing some of our white work, as in self-work and holding each other accountable. And I said, I make a commitment to going back because I realized I used white privilege to stop out because it was just so painful. So I make a commitment to finish that book, watch this movie, and continue. The movie 13th is out as well, about the school to prison pipeline coming slavery till now in the prison industrial complex. So I think that's just out on HBO, I believe, as a documentary. So I want to definitely see that. So seeing with family members, with colleagues, not going alone, but mostly debriefing, I think is a great idea. And I'd love to see whites doing them in mixed race groups and then being open to hearing, just like we had this conversation about the Nat Turner movie, Difference of Opinions. And I'm like, you got my attention. I see the pattern of not whether it's someone that's accused of a crime or someone that is killed by police, you victimize, you demonize. Same thing is happening here. I also want to hold out the fact that it could be that he also may have done something, sexual violence, and that people are complex. And so to not demonize folks only with some behaviors, but to hold it all, it's hard to do. But I think as a society, we're getting better at holding people in their complexity and not saying they're a horrible person because they're good because, but most of us have done things we regret, some that have really crossed a line, but to have the conversation and not just write people off. That's what I said today.
I appreciate that. The other part of that, I want to add to that in terms of when we're talking about institutionalized racism, when we're talking about a system that has been in place since the founding of America. And there was a, I don't have it in front of me, but there was a recent a piece that came out that said, I think it would take 228 years before a family, a melanated family would be able to equal the wealth of a white family, of a current white family. 228 years, that's how the large the gap is. Well, let's really dig down and look at what that means. It means that when you take away a people's ability to economically survive and to support their family, when you take away the ability to get quality education and access to the education, meaning that the modern day freeway system was designed to separate whites from blacks. So if you don't have a vehicle or means of transportation, you can't get to, if you're lucky enough to get accepted, you can't get to the school because you don't have a way of getting there. So you're trapped. It's like that movie District 13 that came out many years ago, where you are trapped on an island called United States of the Ghetto, and you're in this environment. And as we talked about, there are people who have never left their neighborhood. I remember growing up, and I don't remember the cat's name, but I'm looking at his face. And I remember saying, "Hey, man, why don't we go?" This is in Chicago. Say, "Why don't we go downtown Chicago?" He's like, "Why would I do that? Why would I go downtown?" He never left his neighborhood, and that's designed.
Oh,
so
yeah.
I'm getting to a point here, and that is, so when you are boxed in systemically, chances are you're going to have or have engaged in something that might that generally would be looked at as criminal, not because that was a goal growing up. You know, we always look at this and say, well, you know, they're all this and they're all that. Well, nobody went up to their mother and father when they were children and say, "Mom, Dad, when I grow up, I want to be the best drug dealer I could ever be. You know, I want to be a phenomenal alcoholic. I can't wait, Mom, to be the best prostitute I can be. I can't wait to be the most prolific carjacker you've ever seen." This is not something that has ever been a goal. Criminality is never a goal. It is a forced choice from lack of choices and opportunity. So this is something that they know, and as a result This is why they keep the criminal narrative to create that, to continue that separation between the blacks and whites. But all, you know, most all people of color, and I'm talking about blacks, Hispanics, you know, just all people, brown people. If you box us into this situation where we can't feed ourselves and support ourselves, yeah, we're going to probably have to do something to do that. And now you get a record. Now you're in the system, so on and so forth. But guess what? That's not who that person is as a person. That is what they had to do to survive in a racist institutionalized system that is designed to eliminate them. So I just wanted to kind of bring that distinction out. As to why that is, and why when you watch CNN, MSNBC, all the news stations, and you see, and it's going to happen again, the next melanated person who's going to be a male or female who's going to be murdered by the hands of a police officer, you're going now. You just look for it. It's like wait for it. You're going to see their record come up, and the reason that their record comes up is because they had no choice. In many instances. And the other problem with that is once you do it, you have to continue to do it to survive.
Yeah. Most whites don't get this. And,
no, they don't.
And I didn't. And I just judged. Why can't they just pull themselves by the bootstraps?
Sure.
So in workshops or in classrooms, some folks will do simulations, whether it's star power or something else, where people really have to experience what is it like to have very few resources, and you play it out long enough, folks who are in the quote lowest group will start doing behaviors that if it were in society would be called criminal. But then, you know, you remember Katrina, that classic picture of two folks going through water, each carrying some food that they had just gotten from a grocery store that had not been opened, but they couldn't feed their families. And the white person, I don't remember the exact line, but it was like, look what they're going through to make sure their families don't. And the person of color was, it's vandalism.
Exactly.
And so how we, because I should have a criminal record. And I won't go into detail on what I did in case statute of limitations. I don't mean to be flippant, but this is public. But because of white privilege and class privilege and education privilege, no one noticed when I stole all that I stole. I have sold things that would be illegal. But it was just what we did back in the 70s because I was white. Have you seen Queen Sugar yet?
No, I have not.
So everybody's listening. Queen Sugar, I think it's on the OWN channel because I believe Oprah Winfrey is one of the key producers or organizers. It's maybe 4 episodes by now. African-American family in the South, a couple different places in the South. The part I want to bring in here that comes in this one district, I don't have all the details, but it's what Michelle Alexander, I think, talks about in her book, The New Jim Crow. Did I get that right?
Yep.
About school to prison pipeline. That in this district, the sheriff's department's funding was cut so much by the state, the only way they made money was for every prisoner that got put into the for-profit prison. And so they were incentivized to arrest folks. And of course, they arrested young black boys mostly, but not totally, cross-gender identities, but young people of color or older people of color for the smallest thing, and then let them sit in jail because they made money. Whereas a white person for the same thing, this one storyline is a young boy had one, I don't know if the term is reefer these days, pot,
weed.
Cigarette, weed. Thank you for catching me up. Didn't have the money to do bail. They were so backlogged, they couldn't get a public defender. And so the kids sat in jail just getting beat up and all kinds of things. It reminds you of Browder, Khalif Browder.
Yep.
Story up here in Rikers Island. So similar dynamics.
Yes. And unfortunately came out and committed suicide because of the trauma that he faced. And went
yes.
Yeah.
Youth wasn't even 18. But what I didn't understand was how police law enforcement officers were incentivized to arrest because they then got kickbacks and money that went directly.
Well, you could understand it. I mean, that I had Lei Moon Wah on the show. And for those who don't remember Les Moonois, he did a, I can't remember the name of the movie, but he did a great movie back in the 80s. He was on Oprah, and he's of Chinese, he's a Chinese American. And in the green room, and we've we talked about this, and I also had on a gentleman by the name of Matthew Falk, who won the first and only Title VII lawsuit against the DOJ for racism. He won $4 million from that, wrecked his life and career, but he was a U.S. deputy, U.S. deputy marshal. He was a DEA, he was at the highest of the food chain in the at the federal level. And we were talking in the green room as well. And one of the hush-hush things that we have all acknowledge and talk about is the KKK's influence and infiltration in law enforcement.
Yeah.
And we've seen this if you look at, if you go back and look at slavery, even if you look at the story of Nate Turner, the police were policed the plantations to keep slaves from running away, from them congregating, keeping the black people in their place. Well, we see that today. You know, you go to the wrong neighborhood, the police pull you over. Where are you going? Let me see your papers. So nothing has changed. But you also see, and I had another lady on. There's an organization which unfortunately I can't think of it right now. But it's an organization that helps. Black people missing. So it's an organization dedicated to people of color who come up missing. Well, I remember Les Moonois and a few others sharing stories with me about the police. If you know, when you are what we call dirt poor, and you don't have family, and you know, it's one of there are people who, unfortunately, they say nobody will miss you. They take these people, they take us, put us in the back of cars, light it up, burn us, take us to the shipyards and crush us up in the cars. This is something that happens every day in America. You don't want to talk about it because then, of course, they'll come after you. And I'm hoping they will come after me because then I'll end up being able to get the story out. But it's this insidious systemic consciousness that we are constantly having to deal with. It's the trauma that we talked about earlier that you had mentioned, the African-American woman that called you.
Oh yeah.
And these are the things that we have to, when we're around you, white folk, we laugh, we smile, we chin and grin. But you remember that song, Tears of a Clown?
Yeah.
When no one's around? Yeah, right. So, the black folk are hurting in ways that we can't even go and get the proper counseling because the counselor looks like the oppressor from the pain that we're going through. And I'm not taking anything away from the black or melanated psychologists and psychological workers and helpers, but there's just not enough of you.
No.
And so if we can find you, then the other issue is, can we afford you? So there's a level of us that are so wounded that when you come up to us, and if you come up to us the wrong way, we will self explode, and you'll see this with a lot of the youth, when the cops know this. Go into the most oppressed area because those are the people that are the most hostile because they're angry because they can't get out. Right? If you take any animal, even an insect, and you trap that insect, over time that insect starts to get hostile because it can't get out. And so you come and you agitate, and then that gives you the ability to kill that person of color. Just one, I went on a tangent. I don't even remember where I was connecting it, but I had to bring that out somehow.
Well, for me, it's all what we've been talking about in that most whites hearing you go and talk for the last 4 or 5 minutes will just be shaking their head going, I don't believe him. Mm. You get that response, I'll bet, right? Because most whites, because of white privilege, class privilege, geographic privilege, just don't have these conversations or have read. And so coming back to Queen Sugar, other kinds of movies that will have stories that'll open our hearts and go, I didn't know, or to see folks who have so few options because of classism and racism particularly, and then have more understanding, more knowledge, then be able to come back. And so when their colleagues are talking about what happens in the workplace or their lives, then whites may not resist or go, yeah, but go, you know, if you want, I'm ready to listen or tell me more. Mm-hmm. So whites together, families, learning intentionally, not only mainstream movies, because some of them are worthless or at least replicate racism, but there's some really more and more documentaries or intentionally designed pieces to help get dynamics of race and racism and white supremacy out so that mainstream whites can learn more. And then maybe we can show up to help dismantle and partner and follow the leadership of folks of color. That's how I see what you were saying coming back.
I appreciate that. Thank you for wrapping that up. And that was a perfect wrap. Lastly, we want to talk about, there are a couple of things. In this wonderful packet that you put together here, supporting racist statements and also being condescending and dismissive of student protests, white gays and lesbians are whites who grew up poor, saying I'm colorblind, and even people of color who deny the existence of racism. Let's kind of tackle that and deal with those two dynamics.
How long you got?
Let's do show number two, people.
We'll seriously, see you next week. We're set up to come back in a week or so. Why don't we pick it up where we left it off? And I'll have more of these by then because I'm getting more surveys. Hearing you, I used humor, but I was feeling overwhelmed because I have my opinion, but this is so huge, so complex.
Yep.
I think a lot of whites drop out. And yet my hope is that maybe a few things that we talked about today and the other shows you have will give whites a few more tools or a little more courage to try something new. It's like spaghetti against a wall. I don't know what's going to work, but I'll try two or three things. And if it sticks, okay.
I appreciate you. I really appreciate you.
I learned a lot talking today.
I appreciate how you teach whites to be able to stand and be in the conversation and stand in that, you know, in that muck and mire of being uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because it's not going away. We're not going away. And as I said, if anything, the based on the U.S. consensus, there's a shift in terms of those numbers of the browning of America. And so, you know, more and more white folk are going to feel and see more melanated people in their places and spaces other than where they were comfortable with, which might have been in entertainment or sports or caregiving jobs. Not necessarily as leaders, bosses, and people who of people of color in authoritative positions. This is something that is becoming very difficult for non-melanated people to deal with, and or just seeing successful Black families. And their children playing and living, you know, swimming in the swimming pool, playing in the park, and you're having an issue with it because you've not seen it before and you have all these racial biases. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We'll be talking a lot. I see us, this is going to be over a year or two. I mean, we're not going to run out of stuff, and I just hope it's helpful for folks because I sure as am appreciating you enjoying I'm learning with you, and I appreciate you showing up with me.
Absolutely. We'll see you guys. So stick around with me in the green room as we sign off, and we'll set up our next date for next week. But we'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. And don't forget to comment. And if something here that we said that enlightened you, share it. Tell somebody else about it, because sometimes that's just part of your lane. And if that's all you can do, that's enough. We appreciate you. See you soon.